gonna make it!
What'd you expect, a battleship? Keep paddling!
If you don't have an oar, use your rifle butt! Just paddle!
That could've been us! Paddle, Spinny, paddle!
The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd.
We're drifting wide! Paddle right!
The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd.
Move up the road and watch that fire from the cemetery!
Screaming memes! Move up the road!
Jimmy! Let's follow him!
G42! We gotta get past that machine gun! Stay low, guys!
Shut it down before it takes out our air support!
Thank you.
now. Bunker!
Thank you.
Those MG-42s will cut us to pieces!
Those screaming Mimis have to be around here somewhere.
We gotta take those things out!
Sounds like only one.
Ah! Nice work, Sergeant. Elements of Fox and Dog are already securing the hill's perimeter. We'll do a final sweep. You boys head back down. Captain Delaney wants to see you and Corporal Kelly at the CP right away.
What do you think that's all about, Sarge?
Well, I heard Delaney talking to General Gordon about a big offensive at the Siegfried Line. I think they're sending us in first.
Berkland says the U.S. Army consists of the Big Red One and 10 million replacements.
I'm beginning to think Army Brass agrees, Schmitty.
Squad up with that armor and clear the town. Elements of Dog and Charlie will rendezvous with Fox at the train station. Move up!
Let's go!
I hear him inside. Get ready.
Go!
Keep moving! Go, go, go!
Enemy fire! Right flank!
Der Feind!
Go, go, go!
They're all over us!
Nice work, Sergeant. Abel and Charlie are reinforcing the town's perimeter. Anyone check to see if this Panzer is operational?
Saw a couple of Krauts trying to refuel it in a real hurry, so my guess is yeah.
That's good news, Private. We can use it to assist what Shermans we have left. You boys have a full crew?
We're one short, sir.
Sergeant, I believe you got yourself some experience with the tank back in Africa. Climb up there and help these boys out.
Get ahead! walk from here.
Well done, Sergeant. It's more than likely the Germans will have set up a roadblock ahead, so we'll move through the forest and hook up with Abel.
Thank you.
think I might actually make it home from this lousy war. Incoming! Find cover!
Look out!
Get out of there! Brooklyn!
We can't stay here! Cover!
One of them.
Only one left!
I think we got them all.
Sergeant! Get over here!
Get down!
Wait for my signal, Smith.
Here they come!
Wait for it.
Wait for it. Gentlemen.
There's our armor! Schmitty, we did it!
Ha ha! Outstanding.
I think we got them all.
Look! Go, go, go!
Damn fine job, Sergeant. You do this division proud.
August of 1944, following their success over the merciless German defenders on Omaha Beach, the division advances an average of 20 miles a day and eventually make their way to Germany's doorstep. Breaching the heavily fortified Siegfried Line on September 12th, the division crosses into Germany for the first time. In brutal house-to-house fighting, they capture Aachen on October 21st, the first German city to fall. That winter, in an act of desperation, Germany launches a massive offensive in the Ardennes, and the Big Red One is tasked with holding the line in what would later be known as the Battle of the Bulge. Eventually fighting their way back into Germany by January of 1944, they cross the Rhine River and continue to advance across Germany. The division finds itself in Czechoslovakia on May 8, 1945, when the war in Europe is finally over as Germany surrenders. In 443 days of combat, the division had suffered over 20,000 casualties. By the war's end, they had taken more than 100,000 prisoners and received 16 Medals of Honor, as well as the distinction of being America's most accomplished fighting division of the Second World War. From the early battles in the deserts of North Africa to the rolling hillsides of Sicily and into the darkest days of occupied France, the members of the Big Red One had been ordinary soldiers tasked with truly extraordinary deeds. Their commitment to success at all costs is reflected in their motto: no mission too difficult, no sacrifice too great, duty first. With the world once again thrown into war, the U.S. 1st Infantry Division is called into service. With regiments dating back to the American Revolution, it is the oldest continuously serving division in the United States Army. Known as the Big Red One for their distinctive arm patch, the Fighting First set sail from New York to the United Kingdom in early August 1942 to begin their training for the Second World War. Under the watchful eye of Major General Terry Allen, the division commander, the Fighting First was kept busy preparing for their first taste of combat. Across the sea, British and German armies clash under the scorching heat of the deserts of North Africa. Amidst these hellish conditions, General Bernard Montgomery and his British 8th Army had been able to hold off Rommel's blitzkrieg attacks through a war of attrition. But the deadlock needed to be broken, and the Big Red One, fresh from their training, waited eagerly for their call to action. Meanwhile, British Prime Minister Winston Churchill and American President Franklin D. Roosevelt, along with General Dwight D. Eisenhower, devised an amphibious assault directed at the Vichy French-held territories of North Africa. Codenamed Operation Torch, the invasion was to start in late October of 1942, with the 1st Infantry Division embarking for the Algerian coast. Unsure if the German-occupied French forces would attack U.S. troops, bright American flag armbands were to be worn as a deterrent. However, this was the least of the Big Red One's worries, as Rommel's battle-hardened Africa Corps were not about to give in to these young American soldiers without a fight. Early lessons in desert combat, the 1st Infantry Division fought valiantly against the well-equipped and more experienced Africa Corps. Sweeping across the North African deserts, they pinned Rommel's troops on the Tunisian coast. With nowhere to retreat and surrounded by Allied naval and air forces, the Africa Corps surrendered in May of 1943. Operation Torch was a resounding victory, as the Big Red One took 40,000 prisoners and successfully helped push Germany out of North Africa. Meanwhile, Churchill convinces Roosevelt that attacking Europe through Italy will shorten the war, saying that the Mediterranean is the soft underbelly of the crocodile. Known as Operation Husky, plans are devised for another massive amphibious invasion, this time targeting Sicily and involving British and American troops, as well as the Navy and Air Corps. When the news reaches General George S. Patton that he will be commanding the American troops, the fiery general proclaims, "I want those 1st Division sons of bitches. I won't go on without them." After learning the true scale of the offensive, Hitler immediately cancels a planned offensive on the Russian front and orders the transfer of German troops to assist in the defense of the key Italian island. In the early morning hours of July 10, 1943, with the coastline heavily defended and the fearsome Hermann Göring Panzer Division lying in wait, the 1st Infantry Division prepares for another beach landing, this time near the town of Gela on the southwest shore of Sicily. The silence is broken when General Patton's command ship, the Monrovia, and other battleships begin to pound the Italian coast with massive 16-inch shells. As fires from the naval bombardment break out along the besieged coastline, the Big Red One is ordered into their assault boats to begin the invasion of Italy. Through the unmatched heroism of the 1st Infantry Division, Allied forces were able to overpower Axis troops at Gela and Troina. Even the tanks of the mighty Hermann Göring Division were no match for one of the most accomplished American fighting units of World War II. In 37 days of continuous fighting, the Big Red One had taken control of 18 towns and villages. Operation Husky was an unmitigated Allied success, as Axis forces were driven from the island and the Mediterranean sea lanes reopened. Italian dictator Benito Mussolini is removed from power, and Italy surrenders on September 8, 1943. Churchill and Roosevelt, believing that momentum had shifted to the Allies' side, commit to opening a second front in Europe to aid the besieged Russian army. Involving over 4,000 landing craft and preceded by U.S. and British airborne drops, Operation Overlord is to be the largest amphibious invasion in history. Now under the command of Major General Clarence R. Huebner, the division sails back to the British Isles that October and begins training for what would become one of the most decisive conflicts of the war. In the early morning hours of June 6, 1944, under the umbrella of the English Channel's unpredictable weather, the invasion gets underway. The 1st Infantry Division is tasked with securing a section of the Normandy coast designated as Omaha Beach. But the German army is well prepared, and Rommel himself, looking for retribution for his sound defeat in North Africa, is tasked with the defense of northern France. The definitive turning point in the war is at hand, and Hitler's Fortress Europa will soon taste the full fury of the battle-hardened troops of the Big Red One. By August of 1944, following their success over the merciless German defenders on Omaha Beach, the division advances an average of 20 miles a day and eventually make their way to Germany's doorstep. Breaching the heavily fortified Siegfried Line on September 12th, the division crosses into Germany for the first time. In brutal house-to-house fighting, they capture Aachen on October 21st, the first German city to fall. That winter, in an act of desperation, Germany launches a massive offensive in the Ardennes, and the Big Red One is tasked with holding the line in what would later be known as the Battle of the Bulge. Eventually fighting their way back into Germany by January of 1944, they cross the Rhine River and continue to advance across Germany. The division finds itself in Czechoslovakia on May 8, 1945, when the war in Europe is finally over as Germany surrenders. In 443 days of combat, the division had suffered over 20,000 casualties. By the war's end, they had taken more than 100,000 prisoners and received 16 medals of honor, as well as the distinction of being America's most accomplished fighting division of the Second World War. From the early battles in the deserts of North Africa to the rolling hillsides of Sicily and into the darkest days of occupied France, the members of the Big Red One had been ordinary soldiers tasked with truly extraordinary deeds. Their commitment to success at all costs is reflected in their motto: no mission too difficult, no sacrifice too great, duty first.